apostates in the context of the Jehovah's Witnesses means that you no longer believe that the governing body are your Lord and Master and Savior, that they are not your mediator between God and Christ, and that is the unforgivable sin. Even if you are one of their so-called anointed remnant here on earth and you turn your back on the governing body, the same rules apply. You will be labeled an apostate and may face disfellowshipping, or you may just leave and never come back and be a part of the flock of sheep who continue to bow to the governing body as their shepherd. I know some apostates are not really apostate, meaning they were just essentially evicted from the congregation, and they kind of like that label, well, I was kicked out for apostasy, when they weren't. Some people deserve to be kicked out. I'm sure you know these yourself if you were born and raised in the organization or were in for any length of time, because some people do prey on the congregation. But the problem is, these people were allowed to get off scot-free. If they did do something egregious in the hall, even unlawful, let's say they abused a child or paid for sex workers in a country where that is illegal, then these people were simply dismissed, or they were kicked out without law enforcement being called. The JWs routinely do this to avoid any bad publicity, and the Watchtower leadership wants to avoid costly lawsuits. Some apostates speak out about the hypocrisy of the organization, about their horrible two-witness rule for abuse cases before they will take action. But in reality, most likely the congregation still will not take action, even with witnesses to a crime or sin as they may categorize it. They want nothing to do with law enforcement, and the society tries to avoid giant legal fees defending themselves in court, so they basically just tell the brothers to mainly handle it internally, maybe ask the person to just move out of the area or flee to another country. The Watchtower does not step up to the plate and pursue legal means to get rid of men or women who may prey on innocent lambs inside the Kingdom Hall. They may disfellowship them or just tell them to leave and not come back. They don't protect the public from alleged predators. So what should you do? From my experience with persons who have left the Watchtower, whether they left on their own or were disfellowshipped, is just to take it slow. People can be manipulative. If you talk with them a lot on the phone, they can suck you in. And most of all, the most important thing, do not give out your personal identifying information to them. I found that some of the ex-JWs, they immediately want to friend you on Facebook. They immediately need your age, where you grew up, where you went to school, your current address. All this is not anyone's business. If you meet someone on Facebook or online somewhere, keep the phone calls to a minimum. Don't let them take over your life. Don't get sucked into any sad story. Sometimes apostates are deceitful because they learn how to be cunning manipulators while inside the organization. The governing body says that they're deceitful because they don't want anybody talking with them and waking them up about the truth about the organization, that they do not follow scriptures. But basically, witnesses learn to lie. They learn to be deceitful. They lie at the door to a householder that celebrating birthdays and holidays is a personal decision when it's not, or that taking blood transfusions is up to you when it's not. All these things you can't be disfellowshipped for if you're baptized, and even if you're not, you can be marked and shunned for disobeying the tenets of the Watchtower. Be careful who you latch on to once you leave the society, because you could be vulnerable in thinking that everyone leaving the society is a good guy when they can be wolves in sheep's clothing that were kicked out of the organization for good reason.
Be honest here, Lloyd. When I saw your video where you were saying that you were back, I was honestly a little bit happy when I watched the video, because you said in your video that you harbor no resentment towards those who spoke out against you, and you said that you would not be repaying them in kind and that you felt a little bit humbled by the experience and wanted to work together more and be more open-minded in the community. And I really want to believe that that's true, Lloyd. I really, really do. And for everyone watching, this is in response to what people are apparently doing in Lloyd's camp and apparently even Lloyd himself. So a lot of the activists that did talk about the situation that you had where you confessed on camera to going to Thailand, having sex with prostitutes and all of that. Really, like I said, I'm not really that judgmental about things like that, although I will say that if the allegations are true about you talking to a 14-year-old, I would definitely say that that is a terribly inappropriate thing, and that's not cool. It's too damn young, Lloyd, if it's true, which you haven't confessed to, so I'm just going to leave that as hearsay until it's proven, or further proven at least. But now we've got a problem in the community where apparently your law office is sending out defamation of character letters to a lot of activists in the community, people like Kim and Mikey and others, who I'm actually really big fans of. And it seems like, again, you're going behind the scenes and coming after people like you've been accused of doing all of this time. And if you are doing that, Lloyd, if you really are masquerading behind the scenes like some controlled opposition person or politician pretending to look good on camera and say that you forgive and that you're not going to repay in kind or try to silence others and that you're a lot more humbled and open-minded by the experience and want to work together, it's going to backfire. There's too many people out here, Lloyd, who don't like you, who don't trust you, who think you are part of the opposition, who think that you are the enemy, who think that you're masquerading behind the scenes and putting on a puppet face, you know, in the scene of the XJW community and pretending to be a lot more good-natured than you actually are. A lot of people think that you're narcissistic, and honestly, the way that you're coming at people, if it is in fact you, Lloyd, does look narcissistic. This whole letter that you're sending out from your law office is extortion. You're sitting here saying you're requested to pay 3,000 euros in the sense of Kim and Mikey, 8,000 euros. And all these XJW activists suddenly are getting these letters from you. So that makes you look kind of shady, Lloyd. That makes you look like you did not mean anything from your We're Back video. And the fact that you took down the whole I'm taking a break video and are trying to wipe that clean, I really don't like the look of that either. But like I was saying, Lloyd, this is going to backfire on you. There are too many people who do not like you. This is only going to make it worse. If you're going to sit here and be mad because people are talking about things that you have confessed to, and even though some of it might not be true, like the 14-year-old girl in Thailand, and some of the other stuff may not be true, a huge chunk of it is. Like you spending the money from your Patreons that they're giving you towards your work and using that to fund your Thailand escapades with prostitutes. I mean, yeah, that's kind of a big deal. And I've kind of changed my views on that a little bit since the last video that I did, which is why I wanted to do this update. And it's very timely considering all the letters that you're sending out. And again, Lloyd, you're making yourself look bad. You're looking like the controlling, underhanded silencer that you claim that you're not. And it's going to backfire because more and more people are going to shout it out loud the more you keep pressing this issue. and they're going to keep pressing it. And they're going to press it to the point where you're going to destroy your own reputation trying to control what everyone else is doing in the community. And so I really feel like this letter that you've sent out from your law offices is another blow to you. It's another blow to you. You're going to have a lot of pissed off people coming after you, Lloyd. A lot. Especially if you're doing it under false pretense, like extortioning, requesting money, cease and desist stuff, as if you have the power to silence all of the people in the XJW community that don't adhere to you. You position yourself up as the one voice of the XJW community. Even though you say you don't, you do, because you can come down very harshly. And I really wanted to believe that what you said in that video was true, Lloyd. I really wanted to believe that we're back. That video that you did was sincere. But judging by the looks of things, because I look at actions, not words, that doesn't look true at all. That doesn't look true at all. It looks like you're doing exactly the thing that you have been accused of. And I think it's also interesting that your letter, your cease and desist letter from the law office where you're requesting money, sorry about that, that's my computer, where you're requesting money, I think it's interesting, Lloyd, that it looks a lot like Watchtower's letters, where you claim they've tried to silence you, and where Watchtower has tried to silence others. And I think that that's something that all of us need to be alert and aware about here in the XJW community. We're watching. And like I always say, don't follow Lloyd, don't follow me. Lead yourself.
After all, people were supporting him with their own money on Patreon for his work exposing the way that people are taken advantage of sexually and forced. Sorry, I keep being about to cough. For the way that people are taken advantage of sexually and forced into sexual labor. And he was openly engaging in that very custom. So does that make him a hypocrite? Did he give others a break in the same way, like, you know, the way that he was asking me to give him a break? Did he give other people a break? And was all this a private matter between him and his wife, as he suggests, or was this a conflict of interest for a man who had, despite his denying and apparently set himself up as the leader of the ex-Jehovah's Witnesses in a position of piousness, exposing exactly the kind of thing he himself engaged in? So this caused me many sleepless nights. The interview was actually a couple of weeks ago. And I began to regret doing the interview.
That's not what I found at all. What happened was every single commenter, every chat person, or apart from one or two, but hundreds of them were against Lloyd. And they weren't even talking about the sex worker situation. They were saying, he's been bullying me for years. He blocked me when I suggested something. He was incredibly rude to me. He's threatened to sue me. I think there were 12 people he's threatened to sue. And again, it's the hypocrisy thing, because he put out so many videos having a go at the Jehovah's Witness community and the Watchtower that it's called, because they were what he calls litigious. But then he goes out and starts, you know, threatening to sue people who shut him down. So that's another example of how he was acting like the cult that he was part of before.
Describing him, I know this is a cliche to say, but he does sound like quite a Bond or typical narcissist to me. So,
oh yes, tell me. I want to hear the psychiatric review from afar.
Yeah. So, obviously, I've not got the privilege of interviewing him or assessing him in person, but from the little that I know, from what you're saying, people just think that narcissism is about wanting to be the center of attention and wanting to look good in everybody's eyes and about stoking your ego. But it's a bit more than that. So a true narcissist is very, very prickly and oversensitive. So the very fact that he is so litigious, that he's got a list of litigation, I think that's the one biggest clue out of everything you've said, the one that stands out the most to me. The very fact that there's so many, like, if he hears an opposing view and he automatically strikes out and wants it to be crushed, as opposed to arguing about it sensibly, that screams narcissism. It's also one of the character traits of internet trolls, quite typically, that they just don't want to hear.
And so obviously what's happened over the years, the tribes that were most successful were the ones where people felt they had to reveal certain things and things weren't kept from the tribe. And again, going back to that culty or communal aspect of the whole Lloyd Evans saga, it's really interesting to look at. You know, again, he felt he had to tell someone from his tribe, either just to feel better. It could be just to get some reassurance. Oh, come on, it wasn't that bad what you did. Or it could be to make those people an accomplice. I've heard that's a popular tactic in prisons and stuff. You tell someone something and now suddenly they're in on it as well. And they feel the same burden of keeping the secret that you do.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, you're the one writing the book, so I defer to your expertise.
On the group, there are very obvious errors within the organisation that are letting down victims and keeping abuse covered up. And what we're seeing in this report is a very wishy-washy report that uses very muted language, doesn't say anything decisive, and very much pulls its punches.
What are the specifics, the obvious errors that you would talk about? We heard from Tom there about the two-witness rule, which makes it obviously very difficult for somebody to report if they've been sexually abused.
Well, I'm obviously delighted that, you know, the language that I'm seeing makes clear that the two-witness rule is unacceptable, but that's just one of many problems that was brought to the attention of the ICSA inquiry. The biggest problem, as far as I'm concerned, is the harvesting of data on abuse accusations.